Good morning, everyone. We're going to call the Board of Supervisors meeting of the Board of Supervisors to order. Today is Thursday, September 1st, 2016. It is just 8:30 a.m. We're at the Community Center at the Sierra Room at 851 East William Street. Can we have a roll call for the record, please?
Good morning. Supervisor Aboud, Supervisor Bonkowski,
here.
Supervisor Bagwell, Supervisor Scher,
here.
Mayor Kroll.
Here.
Let the record
Supervisor
show.
Supervisor Aboud is excused this morning. Thank you. All right. All right, can we call on our good friend, the Rockin' Rev, Ken Haskins, to get us started on the right foot today. Ken, good morning.
Heavenly Father, we begin this day with just a thought that how quickly the seasons are changing and fall is just about upon us. And we know within the next few months we have about six holidays to celebrate, an election coming up, and there's so many things going on that could distract us and help us to keep our focus, and especially our mayor and supervisors as they have to consider important issues that affect so many people who live here in our town. I just pray that you grant them clarity of thought and wisdom to make good decisions today on behalf of everybody who lives here in Carson City. I pray it in Jesus' name, amen.
Thank you, Ken. Well said.
Pledge allegiance to the flag of the United States of America and to the republic for which it stands, one nation, under God, indivisible, with liberty and justice for all.
All right, we're now going to move to item number five, public comment. This is the time the body can to comment on any topic that's relevant to or within the authority of this body. And I would call that everybody's attention to that. Ms. Weisner, good morning.
Good morning. I'm speaking anonymously due to the retaliation we survivors of domestic violence are facing. Mayor, thank you for overseeing that I got a document in response to my question of where it is written that this panel does not have authority over Carson City employees. Attorney Freilich, and thank you, provided me a document that was a lawsuit and ruled on in 2013 by the Nevada Supreme Court. The lawsuit was the City of Sparks Municipal Court suing the City of Sparks. The suit requested that the judge of the municipal court have authority over Carson City employees working in the court. The Nevada Supreme Court ruled that the judge can have autonomy over employees such as firing, hiring, disciplining, and the day-to-day operations of the municipal court. The Nevada Supreme Court also ruled that the funding of the municipal court is the authority of the board. The Sparks City Council does not have the micromanagement of the funds, but has culpability in whatever funds go to the municipal court.
Well, hang on a minute. I appreciate the recitation. The issue of jurisdiction, as you just mentioned, one, I appreciate your passion, but the issue of jurisdiction that you just mentioned, you've been given that answer by our district attorney, and that answer, to my knowledge, is not going to change. So I'm not certain where we go with the discussion of Sparks versus Sparks decision. Second, let me just say my understanding, and you can correct me if I'm wrong, is that you filed litigation in a couple of different forums, and that the place to solve that litigation is in the forums you've chosen, not public comment. And third, if it's repetitive, I'd ask you to be considerate of the rest of us because we hear the issue. So I'd ask you just to keep those in mind.
And I appreciate that.
Okay.
I appreciate that. Firstly, there is a lawsuit regarding a Carson City employee individually, not in the scope of the employee's job. And
yeah, but see, what we're getting into is I don't want to get into an argument about litigation here. That's an argument you just started. And I don't mean to be abrupt, but that type of argument goes to the proper forum, and that's not us.
I agree with you, right, sir, and that's not why I'm here. If you would let me finish, you will hear why I'm here. This has come full circle. I started out by saying that the Carson City has a contract with Shred-It, and Shred-It is shredding child abuse evidence in these court case files. The Sparks lawsuit is...
On that issue, we've been told by the district attorney that there has been no violation of the law with respect to retention of or destruction of records. That's what's been told to us. The legal analysis given to us, so that answer's not going to change.
Okay, and I appreciate your legal counsel telling you that, but your legal counsel is incorrect because child abuse evidence cannot be destroyed until the child reaches 18 and can exercise his or her rights.
Okay, that discussion is not for us to decide, because we're not the judicial branch of government. That's a legal argument that goes down the street on Musser Street.
And I understand that, sir. The culpability of this panel is that they are funding illegal activity. I realize your legal counsel has stated that you don't have culpability, but your legal counsel is incorrect. And the other problem is, under your policy, under the Carson City policy, excess liability policy, the duties of the named insured, the duties of Carson City are to report claims over and above the self-retainer amount. Carson City is not doing that. That is also in violation of a contract. So you have two contracts out there that this Carson City has, the Shred-It contract and the excess liability contract.
And our district attorney has also advised us on that issue and said that there is no violation or no problem with reporting of claims that they know of.
And again, your district attorney said from the very beginning, Mr. Woodbury said that he is required under the charter to defend Carson City. So he's going to make those defenses, but he doesn't know the facts. Thank you, sir.
Thank you. Thank you very much. All right. All right. Other public comment? Anybody? Yes, sir.
My name is Craig Davis, and I've been a resident of Carson City for nearly 30 years, and I've raised two children who own their own businesses here in Carson City. I feel Carson City has been a great place to live and raise my family. I moved here for the quality of life Carson City has to offer, such as the affordable housing, open spaces, outdoor recreation opportunities, low crime rates, good schools, minimal congestion, low housing density, affordable water, etc. However, I am concerned that the future availability of affordable water for the residents of Carson City is in jeopardy. Some of the facts are that both groundwater supplies as well as surface water supplies are dependent on the amount of precipitation that we receive. Carson City has one of the most arid climates in the United States. Our summertime temperatures seem to be rising while our precipitation seems to be diminishing. During the last 5 years and into the foreseeable future, the amount of groundwater is being depleted at a much faster rate than it is being recharged. There may be a large discrepancy between the water rights, which we've purchased, and what is actually existing, and you can't drink water rights. I would be interested in having the state's water engineer or a hydrologist verify what is actually there today as opposed to what may be stated on potentially outdated water right agreements. Apparently, some of our municipal wells are contaminated with arsenic and uranium. The city does not appear to have any way to control neither the availability nor the cost of future water supplies. If the drought continues, the city of Mendon may not have sufficient reserves to allocate surplus water to Carson City. In spite of these facts, the Planning Commission, the board, as well as our elected officials continue to reduce our limited water supplies by approving a record number of building permits and granting zoning variances, resulting in higher density housing. On a per acre basis, the multifamily complexes use a substantially greater amount of water and create a greater amount of effluent than do single family residents. The board can either adopt policy changes which will either increase water supplies to accommodate increased growth or reduce consumption. I prefer the latter. Carson City's existing residents should not have to continue to pay higher and higher rates in order to accommodate new construction. An impact fee should have been placed on developers and implemented years ago to offset this as well as other infrastructure costs. The Planning Commission and/or board should meet with the Legislative Subcommittee on Water, developers, private and public property owners, the city and state water departments, homeowners associations, park and rec, public works, et cetera, to develop and implement new water conservation standards as soon as possible. The board or its designee could mandate that grass may not be allowed in the front yards of newly constructed homes and place restrictions on the presence of grass with respect to existing commercial and industrial sites, as well as all publicly owned properties. The city should adopt xeriscape practices to the extent possible. The board should limit the number of building permits issued for the foreseeable future to the number of permits issued on an annual basis for the period 2007 through 2015. During that period, permits were averaging, I think, 125 to 150 permits a year, and I personally didn't witness any loss in service through the city. I didn't see a great change, but I'm not watching the financials ongoing, so I'm not sure. The board's decision to reduce our existing water supplies, blah blah blah, new water seem to. Let me get back to here. I'll start again. The board's decision to reduce our existing water supplies by approving hundreds of new building permits seems to be based on their desire to accommodate the wants of land developers and/or business owners. The board's first consideration should be to ensure the health and safety and financial well-being of all residents of Carson City while taking into consideration the city's current water situation. Given the severity of our water situation, I feel the board has the legal right to implement these as well as other conservation measures. Again, I'm not an attorney. Without a doubt, affordable water is the most important resource the city has. Consequently, the management of these resources are vital to the future well-being of Carson City. Typically, surplus tax revenues anticipated by the city to be received by the city through new construction are absorbed by the various city's departments during the following budget cycle to provide for additional personnel and infrastructure costs. Meaning, you know, I'd have to question the benefit of growth. Let's put it that way and look at the plus and minus, what we actually gain versus what the costs are going to be with increased growth. Any additional revenue anticipated to be received through the increased taxes will pale in comparison to the cost of securing an additional source of affordable water. I feel the next level of water conservation will be in the form of another increase in rates, which will unfortunately impact our low-income families the most, and that bothers me. With respect to the costs and timeliness, I feel it will be much more efficient and cost-effective to begin an to begin implementing measures that will reduce our demand as opposed to those related to increasing our supply. My message to the Planning Commission is that old saying, plan for the worst, as in continued drought, and hope for the best. Worst case, one of the worst cases I can think of is you may have to consider the legal and financial consequences of having to invoke a building moratorium. My message to the board is to try and develop a revised water policy in a timely fashion and make this a board priority. I realize this is going to be a huge undertaking, and coming to a consensus which is agreeable to all parties will take considerable time and effort. My message to the Planning Commission and the Board is to make decisions based on what is most beneficial and fair to all residents of Carson City on a long-term basis, not what is most beneficial to a selected group of business owners for the short term. In my opinion, the quality of life for the residents of Carson City will be inversely proportionate to our population density. Thank you for your time.
Thank you, Craig, very much for it. Well spoken and well-written statement. I think, you know, it might be helpful for one of the city manager or the public works department, the director, to sit down and talk through some of those issues so we get a better understanding of where we are on some of the things that you've mentioned.
Well, thank you. And I'm aware that a lot of these things are probably in the works right now. I'm not aware of them.
One's the growth management ordinance, where every year we, you know, before allocations are done, there's an analysis done as to the availability of resources, and that's just not water and sewer resources, that's all resources, as to how many permits can be issued in any given year. But it's an analysis of those resources, and that's done by the Planning Commission. I'd be happy to sit down with you, though.
Alrighty, thank you.
Craig, okay.
Sir, could we have a copy of your written statement, please, for the record?
Sure. And could that written statement be forwarded to all board members?
Well, it's part of the record here. We'll make sure it is, Jim.
Email it to us.
I wrote this last minute because I absolutely believe in this.
But, okay.
I mean, if this is acceptable to...
Yeah.
If you want to change it up...
No, it's fine.
You got it?
No, he's got some handwritten, but it's...
We can get it? All right. We'll make sure we get it. Thank you, Craig. All right, Mr. Davis. Okay. Any other public comment? Anybody? I don't see any. All right, then we'll move on to... possible approval of the minutes of August 4th, 2016. Everybody had a chance to look at those. Motion's in order.
I move to approve the minutes of August 4th, 2016 as presented.
Motion and second on the motion. Discussion. Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carried unanimous. On the agenda, we want to pull 10
Item
Charlie.
10 Charlie. Correct.
And 10 Charlie, for the record, is the list of delinquent taxpayers. Everybody got that? That's going to get pulled. All right. So unless there's an objection, we will take the agenda as published, with the exception of item 10C, which will be heard at a later date. Let's move on to item number 8. This is presentation only. This is discussion and presentation on the wilderness program. Allie Bannister, Ms. Bannister, come on up. Who's doing it? Bring your folks.
Hi, Allie Bannister, Juvenile Services, for the record. Thank you for allowing us the opportunity to speak with you all today on behalf of Juvenile Services. And I know this program is making a difference in the community, and that's why we're excited to be here today to speak with all of you about this wonderful program that is running in our community. The program I'm here to talk to you about today is the Leadership and Resiliency Wilderness Program, which has been in existence for 2 years with Juvenile Services. I brought with me today a young man who's willing to speak about the changes he's made during this program. He completed it this last summer. The Wilderness Program is a program designed to change behavior through therapeutic interventions in an outdoor setting. This program is based through making changes through consistency, lifestyle, and behavior change in physical activity. During the last year, we were fortunate enough to have the Carson City Sheriff's Office partner with us and their school resource officers. They joined our team in mentoring these youth, which added a wonderful dimension. We also partnered with the Sierra Strength and Endurance Gym in order to engage these youth in participating healthy lifestyle and exercise habits. One habit I personally believe will change kids' lives for the better. During this 10-week summer program, the youth were required to meet four times a week to work with us and our juvenile probation team in multiple activities that really made them get out of their comfort zone. Some that were really willing to do, and some that were kind of forced to do. So some of the activities that they had to participate with us on were joining a gym and working out with a personal trainer, mountain biking, whitewater rafting the American River in Sacramento, camping under the stars, participating in mandatory community service project at the Ron Wood Resource Center. They also volunteered their time at the Dells Benefit at the Concert Under the Stars. They hiked multiple trails throughout the community, including the Clear Creek Trail, Spooner Lake Trail, Marlette Lake. They did a 3-day backpacking trip through the Hoover Wilderness over by Twin Lakes. This included hikes up to Barney Lake, Robinson Lake, and Crown Lake. It's a very difficult thing that they accomplished. They participated in ropes course activities, high and low elements. They also had the opportunity to go up to the Mount Rose ropes course up in Tahoe. And lastly, they were required to participate in a final retreat, which concluded the program. The program also included a graduation ceremony, which included a keynote speech from Honorable Judge Wilson, and they also had some of their peers do some graduation speeches, which Leo has offered to come share with us today. Overall, the youth were ordered into this program, spent 263 hours with us this summer, ran down multiple streets through the community in preparation for their backpacking trips, and they did a 3-day backpacking trip and hiked over 50 miles, all in a 10-week summer period. Lastly, bottom line is we have had the absolute privilege of working with these young people, and the juvenile probation staff just absolutely adores these kids. We're lucky to have a community that works with these kids, who supports this program, and I believe after hearing this young man's testimony today that you will understand why we love what we do. It is my pleasure today to introduce Leonardo, and I truly believe that you'll be touched by what he has to offer today.
Thank you, Allie. Good morning, Leonardo.
Good morning.
How are you today?
Good. You, sir?
Very well. You look well-dressed. Let's put it like that. Congratulations, and thanks for showing the respect to the board here.
Of course, sir.
All right.
Hello, everyone. My name is Leonardo Miranda, and I am one of the many graduates of this year's Leadership and Resiliency Program. I was chosen by the probation officer to do a speech on what I have learned and how I've improved during the Wilderness Program. One thing I can say for sure is that I've gotten back into my physical condition I had previous to my drug use. For those of you who don't know, I am an official first-degree black belt in Taekwondo, and I was also on the Carson Tiger Sharks national swim team. I did both for about 10 years, but once I started getting involved with the wrong crowd and started doing all the wrong things, I lost my passion for sports, and it was at this point in my life when I began using. That's when my life started going downhill. I started getting straight Fs in school until I had close to 0% in all my classes. I quit the swim team and martial arts. My relationship with my family was at its worst. I was never home, and I was almost never sober. It would be surprising if I even came home to sleep. I missed most of my freshman year. I only made it through a quarter of my sophomore year, and I missed my entire junior year of high school. After that, it was only a matter of time until I got caught up doing all these wrong things I was doing. And when I did get caught, I was sent to court and I was put on probation. Once I was put on probation, I knew that if I didn't start changing the way I do things and the way I think about life, I'd soon be hitting rock bottom or worse. It was a very complicated process at first, and everything I had to deal with outside of the probation office didn't make it easier on me. After about 4 months on probation, I was informed that I would be taking part in the Leadership and Resiliency Program, which most of you know as the Wilderness Program. At first, I was irritated that I knew I was going to be spending my whole summer doing activities with most of the probation officers and other teens on probation. But then again, I've had almost 2 years of summer vacation since I had left school, so I try to think positive and tell myself, at least I'm finally doing something productive now. But once the program started, I still couldn't get rid of that negative outlook I had on the program. It was hard for me to accept the fact that this was where I was going to be for the whole summer. We would do a lot of physical activities, which some of them were hard for me at first, considering the fact I had lost all my physical condition since I had quit sports. We would also go on long hikes, mile runs, and we would often go to the gym for some heavy workouts. Another big part of the program was teamwork activities we would have to take part in. We'd have to learn to communicate with each other, hear everyone out, and respect everyone's decisions. And teamwork was one of my biggest weaknesses. I was always the type that liked to do things on my own rather than in a team. I always felt as if having other people to drag along would just hold me back. I liked the feeling of not having to depend on anyone to succeed. At first, it was difficult for everyone to work with each other and communicate with the rest of the group. There was a lot of frustration and arguing. At first, we wouldn't pay attention to each other, and we would sometimes leave each other behind, which was our downfall as a team. But the more the program progressed, the more we started to communicate with each other, listen to each other's ideas and thoughts, and help each other through the obstacles we would have to surpass. It wasn't easy, but we made things work out for the entire group, because even if only one of us failed, we all failed as a team. The leaders of the group had to lead by example and help the rest through the program at first. I thought being a leader in this program was about leading everyone through the complications and obstacles. But as the program progressed, I learned that being a leader is all about helping the people following you become leaders so that they can lead other people and help those people become leaders and so forth. This program gave everyone a chance to become more acquainted with each other, including the probation officers. We all got to know each other a little bit better and grow with each other as well as reaching our goals with each other. The staff would tend to be hard on us at times, but I understand why they disciplined us and why they pushed us so hard. They did it to better us as people. They did it to better us physically and mentally. They did it because they cared and because they don't want to see us, because they want to see us succeed in life, and they do not want to see us end up locked up or worse. But they could only help us by teaching us and showing us the right way. We have to be the ones to put our part and apply what we have learned into our everyday lives. We have to be the ones who set our goals and achieve them, maybe even surpass them. We have to be the ones who use our leadership to lead other people in our lives and show those people how to be their own leaders. And even when life gets tough and painful, you have to be able to surpass those obstacles. When life gets tough for me and I'm at my lowest, I always remember this quote: sometimes you must hurt in order to know, fall in order to grow, and lose in order to gain, because life's greatest lessons are learned through pain. I would like to thank everyone here for listening to my speech. I would like to thank all the probation officers, Allie and Ben, for leading me through this program. I would like to thank my probation officer, Mike Rapisora, for being patient with me and being an awesome probation officer. And I would like to especially thank my family for helping me on and not losing faith in me when I was at my lowest. I want to thank my mom and my dad for making sure I had everything I needed and for giving me much more than I needed. I promised them that all the effort and time they have put into me will not be in vain. I told them I could never repay them, but I will definitely show them my appreciation. Thank you for hearing me today.
Thank you for a very well. Right. Well, let me say, I think on behalf of all of us, we're terribly proud of you that you saw the right choice and have started to turn your life around. And I think, you know, that speaks well not only of you, but of the folks that you've been dealing with, and particularly the young lady sitting next to you on your left there. Give us a little idea of what you want to do in life.
Since I've spent the last 3 years, since I threw my last 3 years away, I didn't really get a chance to figure out what I had a passion for. I mean, I am a black belt in martial arts. I went to the Junior Olympics, and I have a bronze medal in sparring. I was on the national swim team too, but I never really got to thinking about what I want to do when I grow up. I'm doing my best to get back into school and finish that. After that, I want to start college. I've been looking into colleges recently, but I think where I'm stuck at is finding something that I have a passion for and finding something I want to do, a good career, something that I like.
Well, sounds to me like you might be a good role model to help others who've been through the same thing.
Thank you, sir.
Any questions or comments?
Yeah, I would just like to commend you for recognizing where your life was going and taking the effort to turn it around. You know, we all have choices. Everything we do in life is a choice. And I have never understood the choices that some people make when it's obvious how it affects their life. So again, I commend you for making the right choice and encourage you to stay on that road.
Thank you, Ali, and thank you, Leonardo.
Leonardo, yes, sir.
Leonardo. And your last name for the record, please?
Miranda.
Very good. Okay. Thank you again. What else you have, Ali? Is that? Hey, that's that's quite a bit, let me tell you. Well done. Well done, Leonardo.
Thank you all for listening.
Keep up the good work. Yeah. Okay, let's take up purchasing contracts, item 9A. Potential approval of contracts with the Community Counseling Center. Ms. Tadman, you gonna do this? Good morning, Ms. Bianchi.
I'll start.
Good morning, Max.
Good morning, purchasing and contracts, Laura Tadman. This is to approve contract 1617-013 for $37,000 and contract 1617-048 for $56,339. And they are both with Community Counseling Center for Counseling Services for Juvenile Justice and Municipal Courts. And I know late material has been submitted for contract 1617-013, and it revised Exhibit A to provide a better breakdown of the services. And additional clarification of services were provided for contract 1617-048, and additionally, that contract will also have a start date of July 1.
Ben, you want to talk to us about what these contracts do?
Good morning, Mayor. Excuse me, Ben Bianchi for the record. This contract is providing front-end services to our juvenile population. They perform substance abuse groups. They do assessments for us. They participate in our juvenile drug court. They're a very active member of our juvenile services team. We've been contracting with them for over 2 years now, and it's been a great relationship, and we're very appreciative of the Community Counseling Center.
Okay. Max, did you want to add anything? Ms. Cortez?
Hi, Max Cortez, Court
Administrator. How's the third branch of government doing today?
I'm doing great, thank you. Right. Thank you for asking. All right. Happy All right. September, right? The contracts before you, in addition to what Ben spoke about with the Juvenile Drug Court, we also have the Misdemeanor Treatment Court and the Mental Health Court Program. And these are specialty courts. These are intensive programs. We have participants that participate in these programs from a 1 year to 2 years. They're attending court weekly. They're doing intensive counseling 3 to 4 times a week with community counseling, in addition to AA, NA meetings. So comprehensively about 12 to 15 hours a week of counseling. The whole goal of these programs is to turn people's lives around, get them clean, sober, crime-free, and return them to our community with a healthy lifestyle and out of the judicial system. So,
very good. We have some questions up here. Supervisor Mikowski.
Good morning, Max. Just a comment and then a question. First, in the future, I know we're working on making sure that we don't bring the contracts back retroactively so that they have to be retroactive. Is that correct?
Yes. I'll be working with Laura. As I had spoken to you through email, we are at the court working always to find funding, and we are always applying for state funding. They have been very gracious to us in awarding funding consistently for the Mental Health Court over 10 years. We've been able to fund that program with state funds. However, it is, these programs are wonderful, but the more and more we have these programs, the more and more we have to apply for funding, and with that, tracking, monitoring, progress reports, and then contracts. So we are doing our best to stay on top of these things. I will be working with Laura so that we can put language in future contracts so that when we know we will be receiving funding, we could hopefully do a longer term or some discretionary language so that we don't have to do retroactive contracts.
Thank you. And then on contract 1617048 in Exhibit A and B, the estimated number of hours and hourly rate are not spelled out. Is that the same as in contract 1617013? Is that the $55 an hour rate?
I don't have the contract in front of me.
No, they're different. Based on
is it by service?
Yeah, and they have a case manager. And so their scope is a different, which was the additional information that Max provided yesterday afternoon, sort of itemizing that what their service is a little bit different. So it's not a straight $55 an hour. It's broken down by service.
I will just say that the case management piece to these programs is huge. We don't have the staffing at the court to perform case management, so we rely on community counseling to do that. And so they're making sure that these individuals, as they come to court, they tell the judge that they're in compliance. The case manager ensures that they are in compliance. They're tracking whether they went to treatment, whether they met with their ancillary services to get a job or education services. They're the ones who are tracking to make sure that they are doing everything they need to be doing. So they're a huge component to these programs.
Other questions or comments of any of the three? Public comment, anybody? I don't see any motions in order if we want to do it.
I move to approve contract number 1617-013 and contract number 1617-048 for counseling services to Community Counseling Center for a not-to-exceed amount of $37,000 and $56,339, respectively, through June 30th, 2017.
Motion and second on the motion discussion. Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carried unanimous. Thank you very much. Thanks to all of you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
What these contracts point up is the necessity of, we're talking a little bit about branches of government, the necessity of those branches of government to operate consistently with each other, because what one does affects the other one, particularly in these areas of mental health and drug court and things where we want to make sure that, we're doing the right thing on the judicial side, but we also want to make sure we're doing the right thing on the rehab and treatment side, which is outside of the court system. So give our congratulations to your folks back over there in the third branch, okay? All right, thank you. All right. All right, let's take up 9B, emergency medical equipment from Life Assist. Chief Shurians, good morning.
Good morning. This is to approve the purchase of emergency medical equipment and supplies from Life Assist through a joinder contract with the City of Berkeley, California for a not-to-exceed amount of $82,000.
Well, that was short.
Short and easy, yeah. Basically, this is to clear up, it's a policy issue because we're actually, we're on an automatic renewal on those contracts or on that purchase price, so we're making sure that we have the contract because it's going over $50,000, so we want to make sure we brought it to the board. That's what this is for.
Very good. Board members, everybody okay? Public comment? Motion's in order. Somebody want to go ahead.
I move to approve the purchase of emergency medical equipment and supplies from Life Assist through joinder contract with City of Berkeley, number 14-10863. In accordance with NRS 332.195, for a not-to-exceed annual amount of $82,000 to be funded from the operating supplies account as approved in the fiscal year 16-17 budget.
There's a motion, second on the motion discussion. Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carried unanimous. Thanks very much, both of you. Okay, we'll move on to item number 10. These are matters under the treasurer. Excuse me. We'll now open a public hearing on the investment of surplus money policy that the Treasury uses. This hearing is being conducted pursuant to City Charter 3.0452D, and it's required that we do this annually. So while we're in the public hearing, Mr. Robertson, do you want to take us through what the investment policy is or whatever you want to add here? I know it hasn't changed since 2015, but if there's anything you want to do, this is a time for a public hearing on this matter. This is how, and tell us a little bit about what this investment policy does and why we need it.
Basically, it outlines like what the allowed investments that we can have per statute. In our situation, you know, we always said that safety is the first priority. So we basically do a lot of treasury investments, things like that, that are secured by the government. It's different than maybe somebody's personal portfolio where they're looking to increase the yield. That's like our third priority. So the policy basically just outlines the objectives of it, how we measure the performance of it, what we're allowed to invest in. And it's all per statute, so it kind of outlines the mechanics of what we're allowed to do.
How's it been working out, in your opinion?
Pretty well. You know, the past several years, I mean, the return on investment for most things has been very, very low. But I do see it moving up now.
Okay. Okay. We have some questions here, and we'll have this is a public hearing, so go ahead and we'll.
Good morning, Gail.
Hi.
You and I had some discussions, and then I also had a meeting with Supervisor Bagwell, who had similar questions on two particular items in the investment policy, which are the securities lending and the repurchase agreements. And so my understanding is that we don't participate in these two types of investments because, number one, they're very complex, and number two, they require really large amounts of money, way beyond anything that we would have to invest. So the question that I discussed with Supervisor Bagwell was whether or not we should just eliminate or prohibit those types of investments in our policy, even though they're allowed by NRS. So I'd just be interested in your take on that.
That's possible. We could take it out if you want that direction. It's just in there because it is allowed by statute, but as I discussed with you, yeah, in actuality, I don't see Carson City ever being involved in those.
My personal feeling is I'd like to see those prohibited in our in our local policy because of the complexity and the cost of those investments. I don't like anything that requires mark-to-market involved because it's so volatile. So that's just my preference. Everybody else on the board can let you know what they're.
Okay.
We'll take that up when we get to the issue of approval or not. Any other public hearing comments from the board? Public hearing, public comments, anybody? Anything else, Gail, want to add? All right. Then unless I hear none, so we'll close the public hearing on this matter, and we'll take up item 10B. This is the actual discussion of approval or disapproval or amendment of the Carson City Treasurer's policy. Go ahead. Gail, this is what we talked about earlier. I mean, we just had the public hearing on. you heard a question from Supervisor Bunkowski. I think also he talked to Supervisor Bagwell about deleting two forms of investment, even though they're authorized by statute. What's your take on that? Will you want to amend your policy to do that?
I certainly could, if that's what the board wants.
All right. Board members, anything?
Again, because we don't use these investment instruments, I don't know that I would ask that they be deleted today. I think that we can take action on this, but going forward, when we review this for next year, it would be my preference to remove those two.
All right. Go ahead. Go.
Oh. I don't think it would be hard today to remove them either because we're just going to take out two sections and then you would just do a renumber.
Okay.
When we removed the G and K. I think we can do it in the motion and it would be fine that we would just remove those two sections. I just think based on your policy of, you know, no risk and things like that anyway, it would just be more fitting to take those out because we just wouldn't go down that path. And safety was the right answer to be number one, so I'd like to see those two removed.
Well, I like to hear the positive and the negatives by leaving it in. What does it hurt to leave it in, and what is the positive to take it out?
Well, I don't think it hurts anything to leave it in because it is allowed, but I think they're suggesting that since we're never going to go that way, that there really is no reason for it to be included. So,
is there anything else? I mean, if we looked at every NRS statute, should we take out other things that don't apply as well, or just these two specific things?
They don't like it because of the risk involved in these two, so I think that's the difference.
But the risk is only if we invest in it, so we haven't done that. So supposing we want to do it in the future, that we'd have to come back and have it inserted back into the NRS, and how do we do that?
We would have to have it put back into the policy if we remove it, yes. But the dollar amounts that are required, like right now on the securities lending, they're really only doing that with people investing like hundreds of millions of dollars. On the repurchase, they're looking at like 50 million. So again, we're not in that ballpark.
I understand your point of view. I just don't know the necessity to remove it if we're not using it. But I understand it, but I don't know if we're going to look at every statute, NRS, I mean, or only this as it comes to the board, we should look at it. Maybe it should be something that your office could bring back to us and say, hey, all of this in other NRS statutes should be removed as well, if that's possible. Maybe that's an idea as well. But I understand their position and their statements. I don't know the necessity of doing it, but I'll go along with it.
Okay. Public comment? Anybody want to weigh in on securities or repurchase agreements? Mark-to-mark
exciting,
agreements?
Exciting
Anybody
stuff.
Want to talk about that?
Exciting stuff.
Exciting stuff. Yeah. But as exciting as it sounds, it can be devastating. So, all right. Board, are we ready to try a motion and see where it goes? Who wants to do it? Anybody?
Let me try this. Again, I appreciate Supervisor Bagwell's thought that we could do it today, but I think that there's multiple references throughout the document regarding both of those instruments, so I'd rather see that come back next year. I move to approve and adopt the Carson City Treasurer's proposed city policy for the investment of surplus money and give staff direction to go through the document for next year's review and remove references to repurchase agreements and security lending.
There's a motion and a second. On the motion, discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carried unanimous. Thank you, Gail, very much. All right. Excuse me. Let's take up item number 11A. This is a discussion of possible approval of the revised cooperative agreement for creation of Nevada Works. Understand your lawyers got involved in this?
Just a little bit.
That's all right.
That's all right. They're okay.
They're good.
All
glad
right.
you said that.
For the record, Michael Saloga, Business Development Manager. The reason that I am central to this illustrious panel here today is because I was the one who presented the original agreement back in February when you all approved this. I am no longer now the alternate board member to Nevada Works, and so at this point I wanted to introduce Mary Jane Ostrander from Health and Human Services. She's going to be taking my place. Karen Abowd is also the primary board member for Nevada Works. So to my left is John Thurman. He is the CEO. He is here to answer any questions that you may have. Just so you know that essentially all 13 counties had signed the original agreement as we did back in February, and then it went back for a review with the state attorney general. They added a particular paragraph.
What'd the paragraph do?
I'm going to pass that on to John because he's the expert on this one.
What was the issue?
For the record.
Good morning, John. How are you doing? Good to see you.
I'm fine, thank you. Good morning, supervisors and Mr. Mayor. John Thurman, for the record, with Nevada Works. The language that was added specifically addresses the potential liability to the counties should the Department of Labor at some point determine that costs that were allowed and paid for were disallowed under their rules. And if that was the case, and all of the other available funds that a particular entity may have at their discretion and or Nevada Works has at their discretion could not be used, then that liability could eventually become part of the counties as a collective, those 13 counties, their liability.
So how did the additional paragraph solve that? Or not solved?
Well, in the original agreement, that paragraph was not in there at all. All they did, the way the deputy AG that I've been working with described it, is that they're hoping to eliminate the potential for future litigation by adding this should there be disallowed cost between the state and the counties.
Are we the first entity to get this? No one else has approved the new language yet?
No, I have six or seven approved today here. Next week I'm in Lander and Elko counties. So no, you're about halfway through.
Well, I just had a question on page 7 of the document, number 18. Sorry, I didn't get this to you in advance, but if I look at the third sentence in there, in the event appeals process results in WIA disallowed costs, then all funding sources will be reviewed as possible debt solutions. And I'm wondering on really the definition or the wording of debt solutions instead of for repayment of disallowed costs, because there's actually, it may be legal terms, but I was concerned that there's no actual debt declared. So it's a liability for questioned cost. Is that what we're really after here, right?
That is correct, yeah. The language that you're looking at came directly out of the AG's office. I believe one of the chiefs at the AG's office is the one that drafted that language that has been requested.
If it goes back, if we approve it today without change, take back that Supervisor Bagwell has now become a member of the August Society of Lawyers, and she's correct.
Thank you. But the more I looked at it, I was like, wait. I don't want to say that because we're saying that we're, anyway, it's a debt solution. So I think that has a whole different meaning in laws to solving debt. So.
Yeah, and certainly I'm not the attorney in the room at all in this case. I think at that point in time, it becomes a debt at the point in time when all of those other avenues have been examined, and then it's recognized that there is a payment due somewhere, somehow, is my interpretation of that.
Good morning. Out of curiosity, if it goes to all 13 county board or commissions, does it has to be the majority approve, or all of them have to approve? Is there a limit how this will be implemented?
Are you talking on the disallowed cost?
Right.
Well, now that's a very interesting question. In order to ever get in front of the Carson City Board of Supervisors or any of the county's Board of Commissioners, it would go through a long list of reviews and potential resolutions through other funding sources before it would ever be brought to your attention. So the likelihood of that is very, very slim. Should it get to that point, then it would be, I'm not sure how it would physically play out, but it would be a liability shared evenly, as the language says, among the 13 counties. So it wouldn't fall on any one county, it would fall on the group of 13.
Thank you.
Did that help?
Yes.
Okay.
Sorry, if we can just, so the first thing is there's actually a granting agency that's receiving the dollars from the federal government, and then these are by cooperative agreement given to all the signing bodies. We don't sign an individual grant document that discusses allowable costs, non-allowed costs. It's not like a standard grant that we as Carson City are signing. There's another cognizant agency.
Yeah, right. So to give you the path of the money starts at the Department of Labor, is distributed by formula to the states within the United States. Once it arrives at the state, it comes into the governor's office, essentially. And in our case in Nevada, that's handled by the Department of Employment Training and Rehabilitation. Then by that, a formula, again, much like the federal formula, the funds are distributed between the two local workforce development boards, Workforce Connections of the South and Nevada Works in the North. In Nevada Works exists out of this agreement, this cooperative agreement between the 13 counties that creates us as an entity. Myself and others at Nevada Works are staffed to that group. So that's how the money comes. Then we manage that money as it actually goes on out to what we refer to as subrecipients. We're a subrecipient of the state, and the state is a subrecipient from the Department of Labor. After those monies get through our hands and into the subrecipient, it's at that level where the potential disallowed costs really start to happen. If a particular client or business has sought services through that system and a particular item was paid for that under the Department of Labor's guidelines and regulations is considered to be disallowed and it had already been paid or reimbursed, because we're a reimbursement agency. So at that point, then we're looking to correct that at some point in some way. So it's after all of that that it would come to be an item that potentially could come clear back to the counties.
So then my follow-up question, however, is, unless I'm misunderstanding this document, and I might need some lawyer's helps, but the way this is written, the debt could be assessed across all 13, not the party of error. So let's say Carson City had a reimbursement for, it doesn't come back against the Carson City for the disallowed. I'm reading that this could come across
first,
anybody.
Yeah. Whoever incurred the disallowed cost, that agency is the one first responsible. And if through whatever and all other sources of funding that they have cannot substitute that for the Department of Labor funds that they received, then it would come back to Nevada Works. And if we can't, through that appeals process as well as other funds that we have, also then satisfy that disallowed cost, then eventually it would come back to the different counties.
Well,
but where does it say in here that the liability starts with the offending party? I guess that's what I'm after, and that's why I was concerned about
okay.
the debt and the way it's structured. I just don't see it in the agreement that says
that would probably be in the actual contract that we have with the subrecipient.
So there is another document besides
yes,
this.
Yes, there's a contractual agreement between Nevada Works and the state, and then subsequently there's a contractual agreement between us and the subrecipient, who are the ones providing the actual services that would ever be in question.
So there is another document besides this that details
yes,
out
right,
the rules.
Right, yeah.
Okay,
right.
Thank you.
Do you happen to know what the total annual expense budget is for Nevada Works?
Oh, Nevada Works is of current year monies. The monies have a 2-year life, but the current year monies run around $7 to $8 million across three different funding streams. There's youth funding, adult funding, and dislocated worker funding.
Yeah, it's on the expense side. And can you give us an example of some potential disallowed costs?
Alcohol, tobacco. Those types of things. If a client, there's all kinds of support services as well as training services that a client might receive. As some of the testimony you'd already heard this morning, some of the clients that come into the system have numerous needs, but for the most part, a lot of the people receiving services under the DOL-funded Title I dollars have multiple barriers to employment and different issues. So there's bringing stability to their environment. And sometimes that can take the form of they actually need clothing or food allowances. Well, within that food support service that could be allowed, certainly alcohol and or tobacco and those types of items would be disallowed costs. We can't buy people cars. We can't buy buildings. We have no brick and mortar type expenditures at a much higher level. But clear down at the client level, that's typically the area that we're looking at that is ever under question.
Let me just, for my own, Supervisor Bunkowski asked you what the expenses of Nevada Works were, and you said $7 to $8 million. Is that, that's the grant monies that go through you, is that right, or is that your actual expenses?
No, that's the grant, that's the total grant monies received, right?
All right. Anything else, Board, before we go to the public? Public comments on this issue? Mary Jane, you ready to do this?
Mary Jane Ostrander with Health and Human Services. We don't receive any Nevada Works funding ourselves for our workforce program and stuff, but we do work very closely with some of the programs in town that do. So we would support this.
Well, and just so you know, the reason why I had to step down as the alternate is because I was asked to join the Board of Directors for JOIN, which is a direct recipient of Nevada Works funds. So there would have been a conflict of interest in that sense. So
can I clarify that is Carson City signing any contracts? So we have no direct dollars coming to Carson City?
The city of Carson City does not directly have a contract with Nevada Works. Okay. JOIN would be the primary
recipient
in Carson City that provides services here out of the Department of Labor funding under Title I.
So then JOIN is going to sign the contract that
yes.
you discussed.
Right.
But Carson City could potentially be on the hook to help pay back money if JOIN went under, or I'm just saying the entities signing here are then validating in the backup then to JOIN.
Well, yeah, I probably now you're into the whole legal arena that I would really defer to some legal counsel on that. You know, JOIN's liabilities only as they relate to the Department of Labor Title I funding that they receive to us would ever come back through Nevada Works and then potentially back to Carson City. All in the other would go other avenues depending on what those fundings were.
So my question is, JOIN would sign this contract, and we're not a party to that contract as the
Correct.
City. We're, however, just a party to the cooperative agreement.
You're just a party to the cooperative agreement that establishes the entity of Nevada Works,
okay.
which we're the administrative body that then oversees those Department of Labor funds and those contracts with the subrecipients.
Great. Thank you. I appreciate you going through this because I think it's important for everyone to mm-hmm. understand what we're really doing here and that we're not receiving the money. It's just the formation.
Right.
So thank you.
Right.
Anybody else? I can't resist. We've got a few minutes here. If, you mentioned alcohol and tobacco as being you could violate the, it could be prohibited. Give me an example of that, if you could. I mean, I don't know. I mean, I got what you say. They're prohibited, but what do you mean? Give me an example of a prohibited use of money that would include alcohol or tobacco. I mean, I'm just.
Well, in that particular case, alcohol or tobacco would be in the form of support services to an individual receiving services funded under the Workforce Innovation and Opportunity Act. And the act does specifically allow for support services, living type expenses, to be paid for while they're doing other activities, training, educational activities also funded with those same dollars. The support by itself is not allowed, but it has to be in conjunction with other services that they would be receiving funded out of those dollars. So it would only be in that case where to bring stability to that individual's life in order for them to participate in the training and educational activities that are going to make them employable would support services in the form of food and or other services come to play, and in those services, tobacco and alcohol would not be an allowable expense.
Okay, that's why I got you now.
Okay.
All right, anybody else at the board? Public comment? All right, motion's in order.
I move to approve the revised cooperative agreement for the creation of Nevada Works.
There's a motion and a second on the motion discussion, and I think on the discussion we'd like you to take back to the AG that you've been working with, the DAG you've been working with. We're not entirely comfortable with that language on, but, you know, we'll go down this road. Okay. All right. On the motion, any further discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carried unanimous. Okay. Thanks, John. Good to see you again.
Thank you.
Mary
Thank
Jane,
you.
Good luck. Michael, take care of Joanne. All right. All right. Do you want a minute? Why don't we take a break here? We'll take about 10 minutes out and get set up here. We'll be in recess for about 10 minutes.
Thank you.
going to call a meeting of the Board of Supervisors back to order. We're now on item number 12. This is a potential agreement or easement agreement between Carson City and the Viterbity, I think that's how it's pronounced, right? Viterbity Revocable 1992 Trust to purchase 8,187 square feet, permanent easement, 8,137 square foot permanent easement from a portion of APN 009-223-03 on Clear Creek Avenue. Go ahead, Stephanie. Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Mayor and Supervisors. For the record, Stephanie Hicks, Real Property Manager with Carson City Public Works. The item that we have before you today, the property is located at the corner of Lynette Lane and Clear Creek Avenue. It's adjacent to the First Church of Christ Scientist and the Western Nevada Supply, and is zoned general commercial with a master plan designation of community and regional commercial. As far as some background on the project, in the 1980s, a portion of Clear Creek Avenue was constructed along the frontage of the property. It encroached approximately 2 feet onto the property line. And circa 2005, there was a need to relocate the city's water line due to the NDOT freeway project. Coordination was done verbally with the property owner, and the water line was constructed approximately 20 feet in from the property line on this particular parcel, although no formal agreement was put into place due to the expedited time frame for that waterline relocation. In 2014, when the project went forward with the sewer extension project along Clear Creek Avenue, this parcel was included in that project. And although at that time, for the sewer extension, the parcel frontage was not needed, it was determined that in order to secure our water line that is located on the parcel, that we would go forward, make good on the previous agreements that were done orally with the property owner, and acquire the easement from the current owners. Appraisal was performed by the Johnson Valuation Group, and just compensation was determined to be $36,596, and the property owners have accepted that offer. Should the board move forward to approve this item, there were a couple things in the easement agreement formatting that we have modified, and one more correction that we do need to make. On page 1 of 6, the APN, the actual letters APN that should be on the header on page 2, have been moved to page 2. And there is a line there, an extra space between omissions of and owner that we will correct. In the actual exhibit C, which is the easement document, we reference exhibit A1 and B1, and those were not designated as such on the actual exhibit, so we are modifying those so that the exhibits read A1 and B1. And with that, I'm available if you have any questions.
Thank you, Stephanie. I did go through the appraisal to determine how the value was determined, mm-hmm. and I didn't have any disagreements with that. I thought that the comparable sales that he used and the methodology that he used was accurate. So no questions on that. Thank you.
The frontage will be utilized for what purpose?
At this point, the frontage will be utilized just to secure our existing waterline easement and the portion of the roadway that encroaches onto the property. So the exhibit that I just placed up shows that that waterline is about 20 feet in. To be consistent with the rest of the right-of-way that was acquired through the sewer extension project, we're asking for the full 30 feet, and then if improvements go forward in the future for that section of the roadway, we'll already have easements for the property.
And will the road be expanded to that line?
Danny Rotter, Public Works, not at this time. We've added the roadway into the easement rights in case there was any project in the future, but not at this time.
Thank you.
And I forgot to ask previously, are there any other agreements that are still out there that we haven't addressed yet?
The only one that we're continuing to work on is the Anderson Ranch property, not necessarily one that we've already worked out and built a water line. This one, the one that I'm talking about, is the end of Washington Street. So that has had a couple of appraisals and workings through with the property owner, but we're still working through with their counsel. So, but that's a little ways off.
Mayor, one more. I'm sorry. And Danny, in the motion, it says for the purpose of roadway utilities and associated improvements, but that's not really the case at this juncture. Roadway and other things.
That's just the rights that we're purchasing, not what we're doing today.
Thank you.
Any other questions or comments from the board? Public comments? Anybody? Motion's in order. Somebody want
to make? I move to adopt resolution 2016-R23 and authorize the mayor to sign the easement agreement between Carson City and Uturbity Revocable 1992 Trust to purchase an 8,137-square-foot permanent easement from a portion of assessor's parcel number 009-223-03 along Clear Creek Avenue for the purpose of roadway utilities and associated improvements.
Motion second on the motion. Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carried unanimous. Thank you. Okay. Let's take up item 13A. Anybody have any questions of Ms. Paulson regarding the condition of the fund in the treasury? Anybody? Public comment, anybody? Motion's in order on that one.
I move to accept the report on the condition of each fund in the treasury and the statements of receipts and expenditures through August 19, 2016 per NRS 251.030 and NRS 354.290.
There's a motion and a second on the motion. Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed? No. So they're passed unanimously. Okay. Let's take up item 13B. This is the potential interlocal contract between Carson City and Carson City OPB, the OPEB Trust Fund for the investment of trust assets. Who's doing this one? Nancy?
Good morning. Nancy Paulson, Chief Financial Officer. This is to approve an interlocal contract between Carson City and the Carson City OPEB Trust Fund for the investment of trust assets on a short-term basis. And because the OPEB Trust Fund is an entity separate from the city, this agreement is necessary in order to allow us to run the monthly retiree health insurance benefits through the city's bank account. An example of this is each month we just send one wire to Prominence for health insurance, and that includes both retirees and the active employees.
Okay. Any other questions on the board? Public comment? Looks pretty routine. All right. Motion's in order. Anybody want to make a motion?
I move to approve the interlocal contract between Carson City and the Carson City OPEB Trust Fund for the investment of trust assets on a short-term basis in the Carson City investment pool.
Motion second on the motion. Discussion? Hearing none, all in favor, signal by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carried unanimous. Okay, thank you very much, folks. All right, let's take up community development. This is with respect to recreational vehicle parking.
Iris is favorite.
Morning, Iris.
Good morning. We're going to just move over
here. Feel free.
Good morning. While Iris gets set up, Lee Plummel, Community Development Director. This item is on your agenda to discuss Carson City Municipal Code 8.10, recreational vehicle parking. It was a couple of meetings ago you adopted an ordinance that related strictly to the on-street parking section that was amended. And at that meeting, you gave direction to staff to look at some other issues and corrections throughout it. So the district attorney's office, and Iris in particular, was good enough to take on that task and provide some clarifications and updates for, and we were directed to come back for discussion. So we're back before you, and I'd like to thank Iris and the DAs for working on this, and we'll continue to work on it with them, but I'll turn it over to her.
Good morning, Iris. Go.
Good morning, Iris Yell, for the record. So first, I would like to preface this by saying that it's only a rough draft, and it's my intention today that, well, I know that you all have read what I've proposed, just to get feedback on the proposal, to consider public comment, then go back and revise again. So just a rough draft. So would you want me to go through it, or?
I think so. Let's go through it.
Perfect. So some of the changes that I made are simply organizational, moving some of the definitions around. If you are looking at the page that has the inline corrections, I used track changes on Microsoft Word for this one. When I do propose the actual draft of the ordinance, it will be done in the format that you all are used to for ordinances. So just definitions, 8.10040 parked, I modified that. What do you guys think about that definition? Because there were some issues brought up about it last time.
I didn't have any issues with it.
Okay. And loading or unloading, I modified that slightly. Going to storage, that was modified to include the definition of recreational vehicle, which is 8.10040 subsection 7. Then going down, a recreational vehicle, just cleaning up the language to make it more clear for the purposes of enforcing this chapter. You all following along okay?
Okay, so so then we're on definition H, utility trailer or trailer.
That one before you.
You looked it up, okay.
Before this one, I am going to, I see that it needs work.
Okay.
I was trying to clean up the language, but I see that
added
it still
some
needs
complexity.
Some. Yes.
Okay.
So
okay.
Just keep in mind that it's going to be modified from there. Let's see. So subsection F of that same section, I just put hauler after the word toy. More cleanup language. So I think the section that probably will bring the most questions is 8.10050, which talks about the 48 hours. I know that you all had asked for 72 hours last time, and I just submitted a different version of the 48 hours, but of course that's flexible, so it's up to you all how you want it to be done, and that's how I will write it. But I thought with the issues that came up last time as far as what if people go on multiple trips, is 72 hours too long, is 48 hours too short, how many occurrences, all of the considerations, I thought, well, let me take out the limitation on the number of occurrences per 30 days and then make it 48 hours from an enforcement perspective. I looked at ordinances from California to Florida. I spoke with code enforcement, people who have had to enforce this type of action. So from a general consensus, 48 hours is easier to enforce, and that's why I'm going with that. But like I said, it's you guys are the bosses, so.
So we said 72 hours, and you kind of said 48.
Well, what
happened? Right? Oh, it's okay.
Ish.
Move right up here. Come on, come on up here. Come on.
I mean, no disrespect.
I got you.
It's
Don't
only
it.
A new 48-hour proposal.
We can have some fun while we're doing this.
So, but I'll change it if you would like that. Then. Let's see, more structural organization changes. Another section that I'd like you to jump to is 8.10070. So previously, Supervisor Shirk had brought up an issue about the number of vehicles on a property. He suggested looking at a property's size, and please correct me, Supervisor Shirk, if I'm remembering incorrectly, but what you had said was look at the size of the property and propose something that is the number of RVs proportional to the size of the property. Does that make sense? So I was thinking about how to do that, and I wasn't sure how to do that exactly. So what I did was instead proposed a different idea to delete that portion but add a provision that requires compliance with the nuisance chapter, figuring that it could be addressed through code enforcement through blight to property. So if somebody had 30 vehicles parked on one property, it could be addressed through the nuisance. Either way, it would still... I would love comments. That's just my suggestion. I'm happy to work on it more. What do you all think about that?
Well, I had a discussion with Lee. I'm going to let him first interject what we discussed.
Well, actually, I was wrong in how it's proposed in here, because I think your question was, so it would allow other people to store other property owners' RVs on there under this version of the proposal. I think what I said was kind of the industry standard around here is that it's in surrounding communities, and what they do is limit it to the property or legal occupant of the private property, so that we don't get into a situation of getting too many vehicles stored on there. I don't know. This might be one of the issues where I think we want to discuss with them about the enforcement implications with code enforcement of it falling then under the nuisance ordinance, is where then there's no longer any really bright line as to how many RVs on a property is okay versus too many is five the trigger. So that makes it a little more difficult in that respect than going out and saying that's registered to another, those three there are registered to other people, you can't store those here, is a little bit easier on the enforcement side. So I think we need to kind of think about that.
So can I get clarity though? Because I'm reading this 8.10.060 says storage or of an unoccupied recreational vehicle is permitted on property owned or legally occupied by the registered owner. So it does not allow vehicles from anybody other than the owner of the property or the legal occupant of the property.
Let me try to remember what I was thinking at this time.
Like it the way
so
it's
she
written.
Deleted it, but put it somewhere else. So now I have to retract what I just said about it.
It is
in there.
It's a which rough
is,
draft.
I did intend to point out again, kind of, and I think what she's kind of done is draft this to kind of the industry standard, as she said, of what is generally used in enforcement of RV parking around the area, which it is moved in there. So it is included that. So rather than do a number of RVs by size of property, it one has to be only those owned by the property owner, legal occupant. That is correct. And so there's no numbers as long as they're owned by the occupant or property owner. There is no limit. There could be a limit based on nuisance issues, but there's no hard limit based on property size.
I personally like this language because there's a provision in here that also says that if somebody does want to store RVs, then they have to comply with Title 18 and Title 8, which means they have to be commercial property. They have to go through the process that we've determined to be able to store those vehicles. So I think we have it both ways here. If you own the property or if you are the legal occupant of the property, you can store your vehicles there. If you want to have a commercial venture and make money off the storage of these vehicles, then we have a process in place and you have to comply with it. Mm-hmm. I'm perfectly satisfied with that.
And I was trying to integrate everything without having provisions conflict with each other. As far as the 060 and 070 conflicting, I think they're okay, but I will think about situations some more. Well, and I think it's helpful because it provides more flexibility in the case of nuisance abatement. So with how it was before, it would just be a fine, or if it came to it, I know it's a misdemeanor, as we were discussing before, technically somebody could go to jail, but that...
Iris, where do you see the conflict? Because in 070, it also says a property owner or legal occupant.
I think it's okay as of right now, but sometimes in thinking and working through these, I find other issues. So if I find one,
I will bring it up.
Can I ask, so Kevin and I have been working on a case in a particular area, and so I would just like to clarify and make sure I'm in a clear understanding. And that's why I would like you to be as thorough as you can in the definition. So let me talk about like a pod trailer. You know, people get those, and they're now seeming to use those for permanent storage instead of, I think, the original intended use is you're getting ready to move, you're going to bring in a pod, load it up, and off it goes. But there's a particular property that has, I guess they're down to four trailers on the property right now. So how are you judging nuisance or non-nuisance and which one carries weight? So I'm still concerned, are we covering the need? So is it four trailers, five trailers? Because I was told that property was in compliance with four trailers, but what is the answer?
You started off by saying pods, metal storage container. So which is not an RV, and there's a metal storage container ordinance separate from this.
Okay, so there's another one that deals with the metal storage.
Yes. Yes, you can't have, and basically metal storage containers are prohibited on residential properties. We work with property owners on the pods when they're actively moving for short periods of time. They get used, but they cannot stay long-term at all for storage containers on residential properties. And that is in a different section of the code. Those are not RVs.
Okay. Well, I'll be happy to look at the other case then with you to make sure we don't have any conflicts anywhere in what we're doing. So,
and just so you all are aware, in looking at the nuisance chapter, I think that it could also use some revision. So in speaking with you at some point, I will see if you would like me to revise that one as well.
I think the position that we're at today with your rough draft is much improved from where we were previously. I hope it makes the enforcement a little bit easier down the line. So I like everything I'm seeing so far.
Okay, and are you okay with the, okay. So then within that same section, I just added some, in section two, I added some provisions that would already be required under the nuisance, but just as an additional reminder, if you're going to be parking in the front yard, make sure that it's clean and good repair. It's registered a little bit different than as opposed to a side yard or a backyard parking. Any thoughts on that? It's 8.10070 section 2.
Okay. So if it's in their front yard and it doesn't have a license plate on it, then it could be, that would be considered not in, right, currently registered. So if it's not registered, he would give it a ticket.
Potentially. I mean, there is some discretion, I'm sure, that we could talk to the property owner and see, is this vehicle currently registered? And then just say, as part of registration, you're required to have a license plate. So then, section 4 of that one is, it's just an idea of if people, what I saw when I did research is I saw people allowing guests to come by permit for up to 7 days, and they would apply for a permit. It would be a 7-day one where the person was allowed to have someone that they permitted to park in front of the property for up to 7 days. So an out-of-town guest, or maybe if you're doing remodeling to your home, where you need to be in there for 7 days, something like that. So I'm just throwing that out there as a consideration, and I wanted to get your thoughts on that.
There are things that I like and don't like about this. I think that stored on private property, then I don't have any objections to it being occupied because it's contained on the property, where I have an issue is when it's parked on the street, because then they cannot be in compliance, or it's very difficult to be in compliance mm-hmm. with the provision that you can't have cords, wires, electrical cords, water crossing the sidewalk, sidewalk or the right-of-way. And that's what you see when you drive down the street and somebody has their RV in the street. They have a electrical cord going to it, and typically they have water going to it. So if we can craft this, if we can actually draft the X section that you have referenced here so that it clearly defines that it would, that it's okay, if that's the direction of the board, for occupancy on private property but not in the city right away, then I would be okay with that. But I think that we have to be very careful. We want to avoid the hoses and the electrical cords crossing the sidewalk or the public right away.
Is it a concept that you all are interested in, though? Because I'm happy to...
The temporary parking, you mean for guest parking and stuff like that?
I'd like to
follow down what Supervisor Binkowski said, and I'm not so certain I'm on line with that one. I mean, because we have very strict rules about how, you know, in single family, you know, zoning areas, can you use a recreational vehicle to avoid a zoning requirement or a building permit or something of that nature? Can you do that or not? I mean,
well, what I would do, Mr. Mayor, is that I would make sure that I went through the entire code to consider if there were conflicts like that. So what I'm proposing is only a concept, and there may be issues. Maybe it'll end up that we can't do it without creating a lot of trouble. But that's just something that I was throwing out as an idea.
I think we have to look at something. I don't know how big of a problem it is, but I do know that people use these as a permanent adjunct to their structure.
Well, now that you mention that.
Yeah, that's prohibited, actually. So there are other provisions in the code about the use of RVs and mobile homes, and in that section, you're not allowed to occupy an RV on private property. There's an exception related to caretaker in there, but again, a different section. Right now, we actually get quite a number of complaints about people living in RVs on private property, and that's currently not permitted. And we do get a number of complaints on that. We do get some activity, quite a bit of activity.
So then the language that Iris has got here is consistent with the law then?
That's correct.
With current law?
Yes.
But I would also...
Except as provided for that caretaker section would be that section, as I read it now.
So as a proposal, it's just a concept. It's consistent with the idea that permanent human habitation would not be allowed. However, since I just put an X section, it's just a proposed concept right now. But then I would obviously rewrite it to
make it
more inclusive.
Well, the light's lit up here like a Christmas tree, so. Jim, you want to go, then we'll go this way.
I'm not sure if I'm in favor of this at all. I'm
not in favor of this at all. I don't like the wording and what it could actually potentially lead to in the long run. So I'm not in favor of this. But I would like to go back to on page 152, section 2. It must be currently registered.
Yes.
I don't think that if it's parked on private property and is legally parked, I don't think it has to be registered. I think that's a property owner's right not to have it registered. And I think to make it mandated that it must be registered, I don't know if that's a necessity.
And I will look into the legal requirements of registration of vehicles being parked in the front yard to address that specifically. But I'm, like I said, you all are the bosses, so whatever you tell me to do, ultimately that's what I'll end up putting in there.
I think I'll look at Kevin. I think that might be a current requirement of vehicles parked in the front. No, it's not. We'll look into it for consistency, though.
No, I'm talking elsewhere.
Okay. So with...
We have some other questions up here.
Yes.
to go.
So I just want to say I'm not in favor of Section 4 even being looked at, because one of the other things is I don't think we're set up to issue permits and
that
have people coming in with temporaries. I don't want to set up a whole nother department or process to get permits. I think that...
Too cumbersome.
And I don't want to compete with the RV parks and businesses, and I just...
I understand.
Right way to go.
And I, whatever comments you are all prepared to give me, I'm happy to address. I'm not offended or anything like that, so don't worry.
And maybe the sheriff can tell us, is a vehicle in the front yard, just regular vehicles have to be registered if they're in the front yard? He probably already might already know that answer for us.
No.
They don't have to have
one. No, I purchased a vehicle last night about 9 o'clock. I would be a criminal if that were in effect.
Get so many days on your brand new.
Okay. What Lee just said was that the nuisance code has a limit on the number of unregistered vehicles allowed. So
I love it when I'm in the minority. So here's an example. You have family members that come for the weekend and they bring their RV and they want to park it on the side of your house and they want to sleep in there. And that's all they're doing is sleeping in there. I don't have a problem with that. It's not permanent. I'm not advocating for any type of permanent occupancy. So there could be a 48-hour limit or a 72-hour limit on this. But, you know, it's just additional sleeping quarters. It's not competing with the RV parks. You could probably all debate that. But that's kind of where I'm at on it. So I would like to see proposed language that we can at least look at that would at least contain what those parameters would be, what defines temporary occupancy, to make sure that permanent occupancy is prohibited. So at least then we can make an informed decision rather than just saying we don't even want to look at it.
I'm happy to do that, even if you all end up disliking it at the end, so no hard feelings.
Well, I think that's kind of the issue we're trying to get at, and so we need to focus on that when you get some language up, and we'll take a look at that, because I think, you know, you're hearing the pros and the cons of, you know, what's trying to go to, yeah. But just to be clear, the current code prohibits permanent residence in an RV, whether it's stored or parked. Is that right or wrong?
That is my understanding.
Is that correct?
Yeah. All under right, the zoning ordinances.
So, just for the lawyer in me, sorry, even though I'm retired, I got a little bit left. Is there a reason why we duplicate that requirement or that standard or that rule in this chapter right here?
I think it would be helpful to have something in the specific chapter that addresses RV parking just for public awareness. And we could always put something in there that just references the other
portion. Well, it's okay with me as long as I think, and maybe that's what you intended here, Iris, when you said section, as long as it's referred back to another section so that we don't get into, okay, all right, you got it, all right.
Just a proposed idea.
All right, so then.
If somebody's mother-in-law wants to come, they can stay.
Well, that's the proposed idea.
All right.
For up to 7 days.
Gotta
or
keep the
however many days.
Gotta keep the mother, okay, all right.
I'm not commenting on that.
All right, Jim, your light's on. Did I get you? I'm sorry.
All right. So 8.10070, but it's actually the portion that I deleted. If you look at the next page, that was, to me, it looked like just additional language. It was sort of repetitive since the other provisions were there already. And then storage, we move that to a different part of the chapter. And then I believe that is all of the changes. So is there anything that's not in here that you would like to see?
Right. The additional language that I sent you on 8.0.040,
yes.
Definitions,
yes,
for hard surface. where it says means 6 inches or 2 inches.
A minimum.
Yeah, if we can add a minimum of, so that if somebody actually exceeds our design standards, we're still okay with that. We're not creating a conflict.
That makes sense.
And then, of course, we already went over the motor-powered vehicle will be deleted or revised.
Yes, that one needs some overhaul.
Okay. All right, thank you.
And the hard surface talks about front yard, because a lot will park on the side where it's not hard surface. Is that?
That's correct, Mayor.
Right.
It's just so that people have that surface and it looks clean and complies with the code.
All right.
And then if you all don't mind, I would like to have you hear some public comments and then get your comments directed towards me about those public comments to see if there are other additions or subtractions that you'd like me to do.
Happy. Public comment. Anybody want to weigh in? Yes, sir.
Yes.
Good morning.
Good morning, Mr. Mayor, Board Supervisors.
Push the button so the red light's on. Oh. Just hit it once.
Good morning, Mr. Mayor and Board of Supervisors. My name is John Strahan. I'm a resident of Carson City.
Good morning, John.
Good morning. And I'm one of the offending RV owners. So I'd like to speak about this ordinance and some of the things that I see problems with it, problems in the future. I'd like to start by saying I understand the city has a need to control parking on the public roadways. That's for the benefit of everyone. And in listening to the discussion this morning, I keep hearing ease of enforcement. I think maybe the city should approach this with cooperation with the residents, cooperation with the users, cooperation with the people that live here, work here, own properties here, and also on RVs. I'm not gonna get into the private property issues and the people that have squatters on their lots and their old motor homes and stuff like that. I'm concerned with what's on the street and what we all deal with on a daily basis. Currently, the ordinance is pretty confusing. 120 hours period in a 30-day period, except for loading and unloading purposes, not to exceed 72 hours. Now, I understand there's some revision going on. I'm hearing the discussion this morning. So is the 120 hours cumulative or consecutive? And where does the clock start and where does it stop? Okay. Is the 72 hours considered?
We can go ahead and answer those as we go along here. I mean, this is kind of a free stream of consciousness type of hearing here. So let's answer those questions as John brings them up. Mm.
Is the 72 hours included within the 120 hours?
So just for clarity, that was addressed in a previous meeting. It's actually been revised since then.
Okay.
But at that time, what we realized is that a lot of other revisions needed to be made as well. And so that's what's being presented today. The 120 hours was completely removed.
Okay. Another problem I see is the enforcement is selective. I've spoke to both the city manager and Mr. McCoy about this, and they've both told me, hey, we act when we get complaints. I got a complaint on me, so I'm getting involved in this. I drive around both my neighborhood, which is, they call it Carriage Square, I guess West Winning Lane, other parts of the city. I see vehicles that are unregistered, abandoned, on blocks. I can show you one that's been sitting there for a year since last year's Burning Man, up on blocks. But the 12 weeks of the year that not just me, but any person might have their trailer in front of their house seems to be very offensive. So rather than address the issues of public safety, blight, public health, we take and say, okay, well, we didn't get complaints about those, so we're not going to look at those. But we get complaints, so these are the ones we're going to look at. So I think that needs to be considered in the revision of the ordinance. How is it enforced? Is it enforced equally across the board? Well, I'm standing here getting the notice of violation, looking at a trailer that's been there for 3 months that is still there, okay? And I'm not gonna call the code people and say, go get my neighbor's trailer out of there. That's, you know, it doesn't bother me. So these are just things I'd like the board and the planning department to consider. The problem's not gonna go away. We can sit here today in your office and the board can continue this and have this debate. and listening to you're up to section X now in your ordinance. Okay, we're gonna have the Magna Carta here when it's done. I think maybe it should be addressed on two levels: A, private property; B, public roadways. And then you can, you know, kind of break it up to the user level so we can understand this. I think an appropriate ordinance would, A, have some type of seasonal parking provision. 12 weeks out of the year, 12 weeks. We're not talking during snow removal. We're not talking long-term storage, but 12 weeks of the year, if an RV or boat owner wants to be able to use his equipment in and out in front of his house, I don't think that's unreasonable. I think that addresses a lot of the concerns and would alleviate a lot of the continual problems of the people that call and complain about these things. Hey, 12 weeks of the year, deal with it. I think obviously it would have to be currently registered. Public safety would be a concern, visibility up and down the street, visibility around driveways, passage. You don't want a 48-foot land yacht or a triple axle parked in front of a house in a very small neighborhood where you can't maneuver around it. Obviously, that's a concern, so public safety would be part of that. And uniform enforcement, I think, level a playing field. If we're going to enforce on one, let's look at all of them that are out there. These are just some thoughts I've had, mulling this over in a calmer mind here. Lastly, the thing I hear a lot right now, the discussion with this table here and code enforcement and maybe the DA, there's a lot of confusion. Is this a law? Is this a law? I don't know. Is this an ordinance? Haven't we already covered this? So we've got this, 26-character document now, 26 pages or 150 pages, however long it is. So nobody can possibly learn all of it on the enforcement or the enactment end. So how is the average citizen supposed to be able to understand this as well? So alleviate the confusion. And until such time, I would ask that the city suspend enforcement of the current ordinance, except for cases of obviously abandoned vehicles, public safety, or public health, until this is revised. Solicit input. Maybe there's been public hearings on this, maybe there's been neighborhood community meetings or whatnot. Get input from the RV owners, the boat owners, the RV dealerships, the people that put this out there. And let's come up with something that works. Get the people that complain to come and sit at the same table and say, what are we working with here? Let's work something, again, back to my original statement, ease of enforcement versus cooperation. And that's, I don't expect you to sit here and answer questions. I'm throwing about hours and this and whatnot. But it's not going to go away, and it's going to continue to be a problem. And obviously, it's a drain on the city resources. You look around, we've got a great city here, and like other places, there's problems that need to be addressed. So you can drive over to North Carson Street, and you can look at the dumpy motels, and you can look at the vagrants, you can look at the garbage overflowing. Is that more of a priority than somebody's trailer parked in front of their house between June and the end of August or September? Do we want to waste resources on something that could be easily addressed through education, cooperation, everybody buying into it? Or do we want to just continue to sit here and pound and pound and pound? I mean, I could go home today and download 50 forms off the internet from the code enforcement and submit date, time, and location photographs and keep these people busy and busy and busy. Personally, I have better things to do with my time, but that's the system we have today. So I would just like to throw that out there, and I wish the board would consider some of these things, especially sit back and say, we don't know what we're doing here, and we're still working it out. So unless it's absolutely abandoned or unless it's absolutely a violation of public safety, traffic right-of-ways, let's stop this until we figure this out. So anyway, thank you for your time.
Okay. Other public comment? Thank you, John.
Sure.
Any other public comment? Iris?
Is there anything that you would like me to address in those list of questions, or just take it into consideration with new proposals?
Well, I think, the point about making a seasonal grace period, call it that, for lack of a better term. I think we talked about that when we first did the ordinance, and there were public hearings on that one. But so I don't know if we did go back to that one, but I just leave it at that. So I'll let the rest of the board, I mean, they go ahead.
So I think the reason that we're here today is because it is the number one complaint that code enforcement has been receiving, and we do need to address it. And it started out because of the safety issues. So if you park your trailer on your street and so does your neighbor across the street, it's a complete safety issue. And so it's impossible for us to say you can park yours because you were there first and he can't park his. And so that's what really brought this to bear. And so even for me, having a seasonal, is that's when all the trailers then came out, and that's when all the safety concerns come into play, because everyone has a boat trailer or a toy hauler. And we could look all over the streets, and you're right. I think enforcing people with their cars on blocks and all of those issues exist in some other codes. And so when you just read this alone, it looks like we're only looking at RV and trailer, but we have other codes that deal with a car that's up on blocks and doesn't have a license plate on it. And if I'm not mistaken, and maybe Kevin can address this, let's say you get a complaint concerning an RV that's parked. If you look on that very street that you're addressing, do you not also deal with the other trailers on that street? So I might have gotten a complaint on one, but I believe you would then enforce it on every other trailer on the street you happen to be on, and maybe he could answer that for me.
Kevin McCoy for the record, code enforcement. And yes, Supervisor Bagwell, you are correct. As a matter of fact, in his neighborhood alone, we just recently dealt with 9 different types of trailers. Some of the trailers were not there the same days we were out there. They came back later, that kind of thing. But just in a 3-block radius of his residence, we have dealt with 9 trailers in the last few weeks. And so aside from the RV ordinance and the nuisance ordinance, we handle everything the same way. We go to a house, we get a complaint about a nuisance at a house, we stand there and look around, and it could easily turn into multiple complaints based on what we're looking at. Give you an example, as of last Friday when I ran the numbers for this year, we are already at almost 1,100 complaints for this year. So the term selective enforcement depends how you look at it. We try to make it a level playing field, but when we go into a neighborhood where we think we might spend 10 or 15 minutes, now we're spending days.
So I think I've obviously been an advocate for the RV owners, mainly because I am one. So I kind of understand where some of the issues may come up in the ordinance. Just some clarifications, there are 10 sections of one title here, a total of 5 pages. The section X is actually just a placeholder. It's not an actual section X. We don't have a section for that, so we marked it X in case we want to create it. So it's not 150 pages or 75 pages, it's 5 pages. I don't think the 48 hours is long enough for one occurrence, but now with removing the inability to have multiple occurrences, or we now have the ability for multiple occurrences in a 30-day period, I think that somewhat solves the problem. I can tell you I can't pack my RV in 48 hours. It would take me a week, but that's my problem. I understand that. So overall, I'm very happy in the direction this is going. I understand, John, your comments, but part of what we're trying to do now is to address those life, health, safety issues, the visibility issues, the parking issues. That's why we're trying to revise this, and we do want input from the public and from RV owners. That's part of this process. As you can see, we sometimes have difficulty in getting public here to participate in the process, even though we may have multiple opportunities for that. Some of that may be because of the hours that our meetings are. There may be different reasons, but we do make an attempt to ask for that input. Sometimes we just don't get it, but it's always welcome. So I think that we're on the right track. I think it still needs more work, but it's a vast improvement over what we had from my perspective.
Thank you. One thing that I actually forgot to mention earlier, one issue that came up, there was a request from someone from the city that we allow an exemption for like city dumpsters and vehicles or trailers like that, because sometimes they're in front of people's homes for several days for city purposes.
For official business.
So
that was
what
from
are
the
your
fire
feelings?
Department, correct?
Yeah. Yes. What are your feelings on that?
Help me understand a little bit more about what that's all about.
Well, it's my understanding that the fire department, or I don't know if other city departments have other vehicles like that. Sometimes they either loan or place dumpsters in front of people's residence for use.
That's a fuel, that's a dumpster.
Right, it's a dumpster.
That's not an
that,
RV.
That was,
well, it's a trailer.
Well, it could be either. It could be either. Could be a dump. Either. Right. It could be a trailer or it could be a dumpster, Mr. Mayor. But part of the Wildland Fuels Reduction Program. It could be either.
And it's just, it's encompassed in that definition that we have of what a recreational vehicle is. So that's why it raised a flag to that department.
And where's the language that encompasses that?
It's the one
read
that.
Read that to me. Read the definition that encompasses that language.
Recognizing that that section needs to be revised, so, but it will end up being in Section H.
I don't have a problem with an exemption for official business, because those trailers are marked as belonging to Carson City, right?
Correct.
Well, so, and if they're used for safety purposes,
right.
I mean.
So official business or whatever exemption is.
The means of what's trying to be accomplished is a compelling government interest.
Well, I'm not sure of official business, but if it has the markings of the city on it, that would be exempt. Maybe that would be easier.
Sure. Just wanted to see what your thoughts were on that. And I will propose language for that as well. Someone else brought up super small homes, but I think we've already talked about that with the no permanent habitation. And anything else you would like me to consider or propose? And of course, as this is being revised, if you think of anything, just drop me a line and I will be happy to work it into the next draft.
So just in a general, when we get all done with this, I did like the comment from the public, from John, that dealt with education. So I don't know what we can do when this is all completed. I think it would be nice if somehow we could put together some educational piece. And that when Kevin begins that we start with an education process for the public on our expectation on trailer parking. I think he brings up a very valid point that we should inform the public and give them an opportunity for voluntary compliance with all the new rules instead of the heavy hand. So I like that.
That sounds great. If everybody voluntarily complied,
I like that.
It would be so much easier.
you'll get more from an educational point, and people will,
of course. So I thank you for your time. If there are no more comments, then I
John,
think we're
did
done.
You want to say anything?
No, thank you. I appreciate the time to come.
Okay.
Thank you for coming.
Well, you know, just as a, I. I kind of sometimes struggle also with, okay, do you do an ordinance? I mean, if everybody were reasonable, you wouldn't have to. And reasonable in my mind, I guess, is what you're talking about. But use that word, reasonable. If everybody were reasonable or cooperative, you wouldn't have to do things like this. And so, you know, but I think that applies just not only to what we're talking here today, but laws, enforcement laws in general. But I do struggle with that because I think that, you know, if everybody were taking care of their property, being considerate to their neighbors, watching the roadways and things of that nature, we wouldn't have to be going down these roads. And frankly, in one sense of me, you know, the older I get, the more I wish people were that way. But I don't know. And I'm not talking about you, John. I'm talking about the rest of the folks. So anyway, so much for the speech. Okay. Yeah. Go.
I move to provide staff direction to staff to bring back an ordinance incorporating technical corrections to Title 8 as presented by staff and including the public comment and discussion amongst the board members today.
Motion and second on the motion discussion. Hearing none, all in favor signify by saying aye.
Aye.
Opposed, nay. Carried. Okay. All right.
Thank you.
All right. Let's take up item 15, non-action items. Anything to report under here? John or Jim, go ahead.
I do want to remind the public that there will be a ceremony at Mills Park on September 11th, if I'm correct. And maybe, Nick, you could elaborate on that just a little bit, what's going on there for September 11th.
Certainly. Thank you. We're going to do our annual September 11th memorial ceremony. We're going to do it. We're going to, if the members of the public can show up at about 8:30, we're going to kick off the ceremony. We'll have a couple of speakers. We just did a little bit of work to our 9/11 memorial. You should check it out in Mills Park if you have not. So I think the memorial itself is much more dignified, and we'll be able to have a much better ceremony. But we're actually going to kick off at 8:42, which is East Coast time, when the first plane hit the tower. We'll play Taps, and we'll mark that very somber occurrence.
So I just want to thank you, Nick, and the Parks and Recreation Open Space staff. I understand they have been working on the pool cleanup that came from our last public comment. So I spoke with a few of the swimmers, and so I'm passing on the thank you.
Great. Thank you.
Okay. Anything else to report, anybody? I did invite Congressman Amade, I think, if he's in town, and I'll extend the same to Senator Heller to come on November 11th, or September 11th, rather, excuse me. November 11th is another day.
Veterans Day.
And actually, while we're at it, you know, on November 11th, the reason why that comes to mind is because I think the governor's going to name November 11th as the Irvin Bell Woodward Day, who is the oldest living veteran in Nevada who died here in Carson City. He was a CB, died 106 years old. He lived out on Empire, out near you, out on Empire Ranch at the Darling Ranch Houses. So I apologize, but that's what, so. All right, anything else to come before the board? Yeah, go.
Michael Sologa, Business Development Manager. Just wanted to let you all know that we are doing a public launch today of a survey for downtown with the construction on Carson Street coming to a close here in the next couple of months. We are essentially launching this effort to do retail and restaurant recruitment in the downtown. So on our website, under the transparency tab, there is a selection there for the survey. So we hope that everybody gets a chance to actually give us some feedback, because we want to develop a strategy, coordinate with our friendly local commercial real estate brokers, and as well as the other stakeholders, such as the DBA, Carson 2020, and the Chamber, so that we are all on the same page when it comes to the kinds of new retail and new restaurant that we want in our downtown. So I'll be going to the DBA meeting tonight. We'll get some opportunity to interact with some folks there, as well as we'll have some manual surveys available at the city manager's office later today. So it'll also hit our social media, as well as we'll do a press release here later on today. So, but wanted to let you guys know first.
Speaking of commercial real estate, as of yesterday, there's a manufacturing company that closed escrow on some property here locally that once they get up to full operation will be 260,000 square feet and 200 jobs.
Whoa. Whoa.
It'll take a couple years. Oh, I would say within 3 to 5 years.
What type of business is it?
Manufacturing.
Manufacturing?
Anybody else? Are we ready to adjourn? Unless there's an objection, I will be adjourned.